How are you going to archive your data? How are you going to keep it HIPAA compliant? How are you going to be able to take maybe the same stroke patient and recruit for multiple trials? You have to have a good software program to build your databases. You know, this is the age when I started with Access, just an Access database, which actually wasn't bad, but you need something better than just an Excel or Access spreadsheet. You have to have a system that allows for follow-up and a database that allows for refreshing. So you can build a database for recruitment, a registry, you might say a registry, but if you don't refresh it once a year, maybe send out cards on a birthday, whatever, then it will become old and stale. So that's another, you have to have a strategy. And you have to have some funds initially. And I figured it was about $20,000 a year. But if I run, most trials will pay us a recruitment fee. It can range anywhere from $5,000 to $15,000 just for one trial. So if you run three or four trials, you've paid for what it costs to build the registry and help recruit for the clinical trials. It allowed us a very dynamic process by which we could customize very short questionnaires and store that information, go back to that information, do queries. So if somebody, once they went on and you click a button that says, I want to learn more about participating in a research trial, then it would pull up all of our trials and we could ask, say, maybe four make or break questions. Is this your first, I'll use stroke, is this your first stroke? Are you between the ages of 18 and 80? So maybe four or five of the make or break questions, if they'd answered yes, then they pass that first pass screening and it automatically comes to us. We get the email. So it moved us into a more dynamic system that allowed us to archive information. And the biggest thing was by having a registry, it's minimal risk for the individual, but you have them there to recruit for multiple trials. So that person that participates in an aphasia trial might also be eligible for a lower extremity walking post-stroke trial if it was stroke. So that is really what I would want to share with researchers is that you work with your institution, get a HIPAA-compliant mechanism to contact for research purposes, then you get some software web-based program that will help to drive it, and you have multiple means of recruitment. So we have a self-addressed postcard. We have different mechanisms that we use to help recruit and build that portal. The storage of protected health information is, as we all know, we all have to be very, very careful about that. So one of the biggest hurdles, which applies to all research, really across the disciplines, is you have to be sure that you have your human subject protection element built into that, and most of it's with privacy, because it's just for recruiting, you're going to be doing screening and collecting health information. So we were able to, we are in a clinical institution, so we had to use the Western IRB, but with the federal regulations, we were able to get them to approve waiver of documentation of informed consent. So what that means is that if the person is given a registry information sheet that contains all the elements of informed consent, such as what are you going to collect, how are you going to store it, how are you going to protect it, do you have the right to withdraw, all of those things that are in just virtually every informed consent that researchers use. So that's in the registry information sheet. So we started off by getting waiver of documentation of informed consent. That allowed us to get a verbal consent on the phone, a telephone consent, and it also allowed us to get online consent. So literally, folks can be screened with this online mechanism. So that's the one thing that I learned a lot about it, how to go about getting waiver of documentation of informed consent. That was critical to our success.